Thank you, musicians, and good morning, everybody. Welcome to Shoalhaven Baptist Church. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to start our song service, at least, with 565 in the Majesty Hymnal, Beyond the Sunset. But let's go ahead and pray first. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you once again for all your many blessings. Thank you especially for salvation. Lord, thank you for the ability to broadcast a service like this so that people can hear your word taught and preached, and people can sing along. People can be part of a digital church service. Lord, I pray that you would bless in this time of worship and singing and in the preaching and teaching. Help us to be stirred. Help us to be challenged and changed by the truth of your word. Help us to be inspired, to be more obedient, to be more pleasing to you. Lord, I pray this for believers, and I pray if there's anyone listening that's not a believer, that's not sure of salvation, that their home in heaven is assured, I pray that they would trust in your death, burial, and resurrection in their place for their sin, and that they'd trust you for salvation from sin and hell. I pray that you would be uplifted and glorified in every aspect of this service, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Blessing those truths in that song are to many. All right, let me make a couple of announcements. You can get your Bibles out and turn to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13, or you can pull out your memory verse card. We'll go over the verse at the end of these announcements. But remember, there are no services on site until further notice, but be watching for an announcement when that changes. But there are two services that can be found on the church website that'll take you to a YouTube link, and that's the children's the junior Sunday school. It'll be posted each Sunday morning, and then the church worship service, the main service, will be on there Sunday mornings as well. Then there's two opportunities to be involved in a Zoom church service, and one is Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for our prayer and Bible study time. The other is Fridays at 7 p.m., and that's for our youth group. So Wednesday and Friday, 7 p.m. Zoom, and then Sunday mornings, the main church service and the children's Sunday school program will be there on the YouTube link. Okay, let's go over Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13 together. We'll read it through twice, and let's go. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. And let's do that again, thanks. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 13. All right, amen. It's good to of course, recite those and memorize them. It's good to meditate on them and think about them. There's a lot of truth in that verse, and we would do well to memorize it and to put it to use, put it to practice. All right, at this time, we'll go ahead and pray for the offering. We do thank you for those who've been sending online so that we can pay our bills and support church planters and missionaries. But we're going to go ahead and pray. And then after that, I'm going to, oh, actually, we've got another song after that, 562. But let's pray first. Dear Lord, thank you for your enabling and providing so that we can pay our bills as individuals, as families, so that we can make ends meet. Lord, we're thankful to you for allowing this, for causing this, for being our protector and provider. And Lord, as a church, we're so thankful that we're able to pay the bills and support missionaries and church planters. And I pray that you would bless those church planting workers, those missionary workers, Lord. Help them to know that we love them and that you are with them. And Lord, you provide sometimes through us, sometimes in other more miraculous ways. But Lord, help them to know that we love them. Help them to know that you're providing. And Lord, we do thank you for your enabling, and we're also thankful for each person, each family that continues to give during these times. So we pray that you would bless the givers and bless the incoming of that money and the dispersing of that money. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now we're going to go ahead and sing another song. It's 562 in the Majesty Hymnal, Meet Me There. Right after that, we're going to have Hannah, my daughter, come up, and we're going to sing a special item before Pastor Shellabear comes and preaches. That's a special song. All right, Hannah, please come, and we'll sing trust his word, and then Pastor will come and he'll open up God's word for us.
Jesus made a star in heaven, he created earth and sea. He's the keeper of all knowledge, what is past and what will be. Yet he offers his great wisdom, so you will not lose your way. Like a lamp, it glows every step it shows, you can know his will each day.
Well, wasn't that special? I hope you enjoyed that this morning. A really special song from special people for special people. I hope you at home who are sort of watching in over there somewhere out in Neverland, wherever it is, thoroughly enjoyed that. We did that for you. Well, I didn't do much at all. I just sat and listened like you did. So glad you could be with us this morning. And trust that you've been blessed so far and that God will bless you through the preaching of his word this morning. Will you turn, please, to Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews chapter 11, and we'll have a look there at, I said last week probably was the last in this little series. Well, one more.
Amen.
Let's see how we go. By faith, we can see a new home. I trust you are able to pick that up in the theme of the songs that we sang and that you've enjoyed this morning. So I'm going to read to you from Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to begin in verse 9. So if you're at home, follow along in your Bible, Hebrews chapter 11, and we'll start in verse 9. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which had foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, as we look into your word this morning, I pray, Lord God, that you would help me to bring out those points, those things that are useful and needful and helpful to those who watch and listen. And so, Lord, this morning we pray your blessing upon our people. We thank you, Lord, for your continued blessing in our church. And Lord God, that even in these difficult times, we're able by this means to bring out a church service to those who would tune in. And so, Heavenly Father, we pray you bless them. But especially, Lord, I pray this morning, if there would be any who do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Saviour, that today would be the day they made that choice, that by faith they might trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Saviour. And we'll thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You might recall a few weeks ago we talked about Abraham and about how Abraham followed God even through uncertainty. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out unto a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, and he went out not knowing whither he went. And that's in verse 8 of Hebrews chapter 11 there that we read earlier on. Abraham demonstrated his faith in God by obeying God. He left his family and his home, and he went to a land that God had promised him. He went there to a homeland that he didn't know about, but one that God had said would be his. So let's see how by faith we can be foreigners and strangers even in this world in which we live and be looking for a new home in heaven that we have been promised by our Lord. The word sojourned, which is what describes how Abraham considered his life, he was sojourning, speaks about being to dwell near, to reside as a foreigner. That's what Abraham did. He resided as a foreigner in a land that was inhabited by others and in a strange country, not his own country, but a different country, a foreign land. And that phrase, dwelling in tabernacles, which we read in verse 9, it tells us there by faith he sojourned in the land of promise in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles. A tabernacle's a tent. And so he was dwelling in tents. And that idea gives us the thought of a temporary arrangement, not a permanent arrangement. It was a nomadic lifestyle. Abraham and Sarah's home was a tent. It might have been a pretty flash tent, I don't know, but it was nonetheless a tent. And we read in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 8, "And he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west, and Hai on the east, and there he built an altar unto the Lord, and called upon the name of the Lord." And so we know for sure that there is Abraham, he's dwelling in a tent. And we also read, and he went on his journey from south even to Bethel, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning between Bethel and Hai. And so that's a little further on in the book of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 13, verse 3. But you probably think, well, didn't everybody lived in tents, didn't they? Well, no, they didn't. Many people lived in perhaps stone or mud brick homes or something fairly substantial. Not everybody lived in tents. Remember Lot, Abraham's nephew, who travelled with him from Ur of the Chaldees and there to the Promised Land, and decided he was going to go his own separate way. And he went off and down to the plains where they were well watered, and he thought this would be a better place. And there was the city of Sodom. And Lot moved into that city. There was a city that was built with stones and bricks and whatever else it was built with. It wasn't a tent. So not everybody lived in tents. Lot moved to a more permanent setting. He'd lost that pilgrim way. He had decided that this was the place he was going to be, and that he wasn't prepared to move on, perhaps as the Lord had asked him to. And so he moved out of a tent into a house. But Abram was always a pilgrim. Genesis chapter 13, verse 18 tells us this. When Abraham removed his tent and came to dwell in the plain of Marine, which is Hebron, and built there an altar unto the Lord. Don't I get tricked on those silly little words from time to time? You know how to pronounce it. That's great. Someone will teach me that one day. Abraham was still dwelling in tents. I guess that's the point I want to make. Forget about the pronunciation. And there in a tent, the Lord appeared to him. The Bible tells us in Genesis 23, and the Lord appeared unto, Genesis 18, and the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre, and he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. There he was, still in his tent, in the heat of the day. Sarah was with him. And these men said unto him at one point, where is Sarah thy wife? And he said unto, behold, in the tent. Much later, after Sarah had passed away, after she had died, we read that Abraham was looking for a burial place. And so he spoke to the people who inhabited the land. And he said, I'm a stranger and a sojourner with you. Give me a possession of a burying place with you, that I may bury my dead out of my sight. Abraham didn't consider himself to possess any part of the land at this point in time. He was sojourning. He was traveling through. He was doing as the Lord had asked him to do, and he was traveling in the land. Come with me now to the New Testament and read what the Apostle Peter has to say. He says this, and if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Peter says this is just a passing sort of this is a journey, and you want to spend that time, your journey here, in fear of the Lord. And then further on he says, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. That's 1 Peter chapter 2 and in verse 11. So we need to have a pilgrim's mindset. Why? What's it about, this pilgrim kind of way of life, this pilgrim mindset? What does it give us? Well, I think firstly it gives us motivation to abstain from sin, to die to sinful desires. A citizen of a country has a different view of the country in which they live. Perhaps a complacent security even, and a lack of appreciation that a pilgrim can't afford to have. It may be the lack of a pilgrim mindset could account for the low resistance that many Christians have to sin. We get comfortable in our place. We get used to being here and feeling like it's home and feeling like we're immovable here. We're very comfortable. Sin no longer bothers us here in this world because sin is all around us. We see it every day. We hear it very often. We become comfortable with sin. John wrote in his first letter, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him." We're not to love the world to that point whereby we've forgotten about God, whereby we love the things of the world more than the things of God. But how about our eternal perspective? When we think we have a permanent home on earth, perhaps we'll think we're really safe and secure and we'll not worry too much about what God has to say. We may have failed to obey God. Paul wrote to the Colossians, and in Colossians chapter 3 and the first couple of verses, he said this, set your affections on things above, not on the things of earth. Then consider the matter of comfort and encouragement to keep serving the Lord someday. Someday, you know, we will enjoy our meeting with the Saviour. I know we will. The Bible tells us that we'll see him as he is. The Bible tells us that this will be a blessed time. There'll be a heavenly place for us. Jesus said to his disciples, "I go to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would have told you." That's John chapter 14. And that's how it will be. But will there be a citizenship ceremony? Well, I'm not sure if there will be or not, perhaps. In Philippians chapter 3 and verses 20 and 21, Paul wrote this, "For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body." Our conversation, our lifestyle, our way of life, the things that we hold dear to us, they ought to be in heaven because that's where we're going to end up. Well, I hope that's where you're going to end up. And there are rewards. In Revelation chapter 22 and in verse 12, the Lord says, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be." In other parts of the scriptures, in 1 Corinthians, some other places, we find that there are rewards for those who have been faithful to serve the Lord. So the Lord says, "I'm coming quickly and my reward is with me." So there are rewards as we look for heaven. And rest. You know, rest is coming. Some days I think that life is a bit of a battle. Some days it's a bit of a struggle. Rest is coming. There's going to be a time of rest. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 9, the Bible says, "There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God." And that rest is going to be found in our heavenly place. We can rest in the truth of our salvation, in the truth of God's word, and we can rest in the hope of a place in heaven. No more sin. No more trouble in that department. Absolute holiness at last. In 1 John chapter 3 in the second verse, John writes and says, "Beloved, now we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And we know the Lord Jesus Christ was sinless. That'll be amazing. No sin in heaven. What a wonderful thing that will be. So there will be some comfort in the fact that heaven awaits for us. Will there be a welcoming committee? Will there be a citizenship ceremony? I don't know. And I'm not sure if I'm bothered much. I think it'll be good just to get there. When Theodore Roosevelt, the one-time president of the United States, went on a hunting safari to Africa, he was away for a few weeks, and on his return home, coming back on the same ship as him, was a missionary who had been in Africa for a lot of years, about 40 years, and was returning home after all those years of service in Africa. And when the ship docked, there were great crowds of people there, all welcoming and cheering for Theodore Roosevelt, for the president. And momentarily, the man of God was sort of filled with a kind of a pity as he thought about himself. And he thought, when the president returns from being away for just a few weeks, everybody's delighted to see him come back. There are great crowds to welcome him. But I've been away for a lifetime serving the Lord, and there's nobody here to welcome me. And then it was as if the Lord whispered in his ear, "My son, you're not home yet." Now, we need to think about that some days. You know, we're not home yet. Our home is in heaven. That's where we'll feel comfortable. That's where there'll be a welcoming committee. Beloved, this world is not our home. Our home is better than this. Sometimes we look out at a glorious scene that the Lord has created, you know, the sunset or the ocean or the forest or whatever it is, and we look at that and we think, oh, that's wonderful. I wonder if heaven's like that. Heaven's better than that. Someday all heartache will be gone. Someday Jesus will come to claim his own. Sorrow will be over. Every tear will be wiped away. So when in this world we're feeling stress and strain and pain, someday it'll all be over. Someday, that day when we get to go home, our pilgrimage will be over and there'll be no more tears, only joy. But let me share with you just briefly some thoughts about homes of believers. Focus on heaven just for a few minutes. Christian, when was the last time that you thought about heaven? When was the last time you gave much contemplation to your eternal home? It's not something we do every day, perhaps. And perhaps you don't at all. Perhaps you think that you're far too young to have to worry about heaven just yet. But you never know when you may arrive at heaven's door. So let's have a look at three homes of the believer. There is our past home called the world. We came out of it, according to verse 15 here, therefore sprang even, verse 15, let me get the right verse. And truly, if they had been mindful of a country from whence they came out, right? We have come out of this world. There was a time, I trust, that you trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Saviour. If that hasn't yet happened for you, if you've never by faith trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, then you can do that right now. You can pray and ask Jesus Christ to save you from the penalty of your sin, and you too can have a wonderful home in heaven. Amen. We came out of this world. Apostle Paul reminds us of this. He says, "Behold, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things includes that which we call home. And so our home no longer is this place that we call this world, because we've trusted Christ and we've come out of that. We have a present home, though, a strange country now. We're sojourning. The sojourn is to stay somewhere temporarily, as we found that Abraham was doing. To consider your citizenship in this country simply to be a temporary thing. This is not a permanent place of residence. Abraham realized he was just passing through for a while. So it is for us. You know, this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. And that's how we ought to feel. And that is so well expressed. We ought to feel like that, living as a pilgrim here on earth, looking for our heavenly home, our future home. It's called a better country. We see it there in verse 16 in our text. But now they desired a better country, that is a heavenly, right? A heavenly country, a better country. And they looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God, it tells us in verse 10. What do foundations tell us about? Foundations speak about something permanent, something solid. You've laid down the foundations. There in heaven, the foundations of our home are laid down. The Bible tells us the walls of heaven have 12 foundations, according to Revelation chapter 21. You can find it there. Notice how a person of faith is characterized. When you look at Abraham, you'll see it. Abraham is looking for a city. He's looking for it. And then notice him seeking it, actively searching for that city. Tells us that in verse 14. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. They're looking for it. Are we looking for a country? Are we seeking for a place in heaven? Actively searching. Finally, we find that Abraham is desiring this heavenly city. And we see that there in verse 16. So he looks at this and he wants it. He desires it. Do you look forward to that? Do you look forward to being in heaven? Paul wrote to Timothy and said this, I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them that also love his appearing. We're looking for that place in heaven. Paul says, I know my time is short, but I'm looking for a place in heaven. Christian, has your focus been turned away from your heavenly home? Have you become too attached to life here on earth? A pilgrim's life. That's what you need, a pilgrim's life. So just for a few minutes, let's look now at how it might be to be a traveler, to be a pilgrim in a foreign land. This land which you find yourself in. You'll notice that there are different words in a strange land. Now, for instance, if I'm right, I believe what we in Australia call thongs are to New Zealanders jandals, and to Americans they're flip-flops. And many a time I've had a discussion about tomato and tomato and ketchup and stuff like that. It's different, isn't it? And if we as Christians have a home in heaven, we are different. Not just for the sake of being different, we ought to be different, but because we're aiming to have a righteous life that will bring honour to God. Whereas the world, they're not worried about bringing honor to God at all. They're just here, they think, for a short time to have a good time. There should be a significant difference in our lives simply because we've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't help but be different. The Word of God reminds us, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on those things above, not on the things on the earth. You've heard it said, haven't you, many times. Home is where the heart is. You've been away sometimes, you go away, and then you come back to your little house, your home, wherever it might be here on earth, and you just say, wow, it's so nice to be home. Imagine how that's going to be when we walk through the pearly gates and look on those golden streets of heaven. So nice to be home, because home is where the heart is. When you're soul journeying, you're passing through. You don't want to be weighed down with too many things. You don't want too many worldly possessions. When we're heavily invested in this world, we may be less interested in what's ahead of us, where heaven is. And we need to be thinking about heaven from time to time. Let me ask you a question or two. Have you ever left your home or your country of birth? If so, did you become a citizen of the new country? If you didn't do that yourself, you probably know somebody who has. I remember very much when Mrs. Shellabear and I went from Western Australia to North Queensland. It's a different country. My friends in North Queensland, I love you. But it's different. So different. There are times like that, aren't there? You know, we go somewhere and it's just different. If you haven't done that yourself, you'll probably know somebody who has, who's gone to a different place. Now think about when you trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Saviour and your new life in Christ began. It was different. Something changed. I know for me it did, and I'm sure it did for you. Did you realise your homeland is now where your heavenly Father is? You know, when we trust the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Saviour, the Bible tells us we become part of God's family. God becomes our heavenly Father. So where's our home? Where our Heavenly Father is. So our home is in heaven. So that is where your citizenship is. It's been transferred to heaven. Have you transferred your citizenship from earth to heaven by faith in Jesus Christ? By being born again? By trusting Jesus Christ as your personal Saviour? This old world of ours here is therefore not your home. Now I understand in many ways this world is all that we know. It is therefore the thing that we compare other things to. But by faith we can see a new home, just as Abraham did. Abraham saw a new home. God gave him that vision of that heavenly place. Be like Abraham. Don't be like Lot's wife. If you know the story of Lot, as he and his wife left Sodom before it was destroyed, she looked back, I believe, with longing eyes to what was, not looking forward to what would be. And the Bible tells us the Lord turned it into a pillar of salt. But by faith we can see a new home. Don't look back to that old way, to that old home, to that place you used to call home. I hope you're longing for a place in heaven. Now, I don't mean that you're ready to give up on life today. Don't do that. Don't do that. If you're seriously thinking about that, give me a call. Hey, I really don't want you to do that. But there will come a time when the Lord will say, your time is done. And are your affections set in heaven? I hope they are. The Bible says of Abraham, by faith he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Abraham lived 175 years. I don't expect any of us will live that long. But like Abraham, we ought to be looking for that heavenly home, that place that the builder and maker of it is God. That's a promise that we have. That's a promise that's ours by faith, a promise that brings hope as we, as believers, trust God. And that promise is the place of rest for a weary soul. As the songwriter wrote, there's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. By faith we can see God's provision of a future home. Have you trusted Jesus Christ? Have you by faith accepted his sacrifice on Calvary's cross? Are you looking for a heavenly home? I hope you are. What a wonderful thing to have to look forward to, even in these strange and unusual times. Be as Abraham was, looking for that city, that place that God has prepared for you. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we praise you. We thank you, Lord, for all your goodness. Thank you for the blessings that you bring us. Lord, thank you for the hope of heaven. Lord, that place that you've prepared for us, that place that Jesus promised we would have as we trusted in him. And Lord God, we'll thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor Hall, would you come and lead us in a closing hymn? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Well, I wanted to comment earlier. Thank you for that, first of all, Pastor. I wanted to comment on how really powerful the songs were, how they affected me as we were just singing them. But then the message, even more powerful. By faith, we can see our new home. What a great thought. Thank you again, Pastor. Aren't you glad we have a Bible that we can trust, a God that we can trust? We're going to close with 564 in the Sweet By and By, just a little melodic reminder of our new home. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the we Amen. I hope you're looking forward to the new home. If you're a new creature, if you've been saved, I hope you're looking forward to that new home. I hope you've got the faith to see that new home that Pastor was talking about today from Hebrews 11, where we that are saved can enjoy so many things, but being with our loved ones and being with our Heavenly Father who saved us. What a blessing. Let's thank Him, and let's go throughout the week thanking Him and living for Him as pilgrims in this old world, because we're looking for a better country and waiting for it. Heavenly Father, thank You for the first of all, the word that You've given to us, Your word, the Bible. Lord, thank You for the truths in it. Thank You that we can trust every promise that You've given, everything that You've stated. And Lord, thank You for saving us. Thank You for giving us blessings in this life. Thank You for the great assurance of a better country, a better home, an eternal home with You in glory, Lord, in heaven. Thank You for these truths. Help us to see that new home. Help us to live like we're heading for it and looking forward to it. Lord, please help us to not be pulled aside or distracted or too much in love with this world and this place that we're just sojourning in. Help us to remember these truths. Help us to remember Abraham and the others in Hebrews 11. Help us to see our new home in heaven by faith. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.